And for this second part, welcome to Dr. Caterina Casalova, who is a PhD fellow in the Department of International and European Law at the Faculty of Law in the Masaryk University of Brno. Welcome, good morning, and we start the second part of this session with your presentation. I remind you, please, to limit your presentation within 30 minutes. The title of your presentation is Detention of a Child in the Light of EU Asylum and Migration Law. Please, the floor is yours. We cannot listen to you.
Hi, thank you for this introduction. I will share my presentation.
Have you a PowerPoint to show us?
Yeah, I have. Can you see it?
Yes, okay, thank you.
Hello again, thank you for the introduction. I'm really glad you joined the conference today. My name is Caterina Casalova, as was said already. I am speaking to you from the Czech Republic, from the city of Brno, and actually I am now at my work, which is Supreme Administrative Court of the Czech Republic, where I clerk for a judge. And a big part of my job is actually concentrated on the asylum and migration law of the European Union. That's why we are here today to speak about the topic of detention of a child in the light of the EU asylum and migration law. We will go briefly through some statistics. After, I will try to outline the definition of immigration detention. I will also outline the importance of Convention on the Rights of the Child. And at the end, I will go briefly through the legal framework of the European Union, which is concentrated on the detention of migrant children. In recent years, there has been a sharp increase in the number of children migrating across the external borders of European Union. In 2019, over 700,000 of third country nationals applied for asylum in the European Union, and approximately 30% of these were children. And more than 17,000 were unaccompanied children. Interesting fact is that with the pandemic of COVID, as the result of the pandemic, the number of asylum applications fell rapidly. In April, only 8,700 applications were registered in the EU, which is the lowest number since 2008. But I think in the next months, the applications will increase again. What is happening with the children crossing the borders with the EU is the fact that very often they end up in the detention facilities where they wait for their migration status to be settled. Unfortunately, there are no reliable data on how many children are detained for immigration-related purposes in the EU. But according to UN Global Study on Children Deprived of Liberty, at least 330,000 children are detained for migration-related purposes per year over the world. So the number is quite big, given the fact that the detention of a child can have irreversible consequences on his or her mental or physical health. Concerning the definition of immigration detention, as you can see, it can be described as the deprivation of liberty of non-citizens for reasons related to their immigration status. EU asylum law permits states to detain non-EU citizens during three procedures, as you can see on the screen. The first procedure is regulated by Return Directive, which sets out common standards and procedures to be applied in member states for returning illegally staying third country nationals. The second type is a detention regulated by Reception Conditions Directive, which allows member states to detain asylum seekers. And the third and the last type is detention under the Dublin transfer rules, specifically Dublin regulation. This regulation relates to intra-European transfer procedures of non-citizens to a country responsible for examining their asylum claim. However, in the presentation, I will speak and go through the first two types. The third type I will not be speaking about. As I said at the beginning, we need to briefly speak about the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which is the most important international instrument governing children's rights. It's a legally binding international agreement setting out the civil, political, economic, social, and cultural rights of every child, regardless of their race, religion, or abilities. With 193 state parties, the CRC is the most widely ratified of all UN, human treaties, and is generally regarded as the key instrument on the rights of the child. It includes 39 substantive rights, one of which relates to the asylum context, and it's specifically Article 22. Which establishes the right of the asylum-seeking and refugee child to appropriate protection and humanitarian assistance in the enjoyment of applicable rights in the conventions. As you can see on the screen, the convention includes four general principles, which is the principle of non-discrimination, principle of best interest of the child, the right to life, survival and development, and the right of the child to be heard. I will further speak about the best interest of the child. These principles are of horizontal application across all other convention rights. In that sense, they form all substantive rights of the convention. The question arises about the obligation of the EU to comply with the CRC articles, with the CRC rights. The answer is not easy because all EU member states are state parties to the CRC. However, the EU has not acceded to the CRC, and so neither the EU nor EU member states are directly bound by the convention when they implement EU law. Nevertheless, the rights of the CRC have been indirectly embodied into EU law through various different ways. Since I don't have time to explain you all the ways in which the CRC got into the EU law, I will say just one specific example, and it's the Article 24, Paragraph 2 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, which is directly based on the Convention on the Rights of the Child. Of particular note is Article 24, Paragraph 2, as I said, which establishes the best interest principle. And as we all know, the EU secondary legislation and national measures that implement EU law must conform to the rights of the Charter. Therefore, they must conform to the best interest principle as it is encapsulated by the Article 24, Paragraph 2, Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. Speaking about best interests of the child, we can't expect any strict definition, since this is an ambiguous concept, which does not have one definition. It's because interest of one child, best interest of one child, can be different from the interest of the other child. Therefore, it must be individually assessed, case by case. And so, as I said, it's a complex concept that combines three partial aspects. First of all, the best interest of the child is the substantive right of a child to always consider and exercise the best interest of the child when making decision which affects the child. Second of all, the best interest principle serves as the principle of the interpretation of the law, which means that interpretation that effectively fulfills the best interest principle should be always chosen over the interpretation that does not include best interest principle. And third of all, and the final, is that the best interest principle also serves as a procedural rule that the decision-making process must include an assessment of the possible impact of the decision on a particular child. As we can see, it is encapsulated in Article 3, Paragraph 1 of CRC, and it provides a critical additional safeguard for children seeking international protection, between others. It is often called umbrella provision, that mandates that the best interests of the child shall be a primary consideration in all actions concerning children. So, as we can understand, this principle is crucial for children involved in migration procedures, as it is the responsibility of the state and their authorities to ensure that the best interest of the child is a priority in the decision-making process, whether it is to allow the child to enter or return of the child to the country of origin. And as we seen at the beginning of the presentation, it is often emphasized by international and non-governmental organizations that the practice of detaining children for the purposes of migration and asylum procedures can never be in line with this principle. However, this practice is very often used, highly used, in member states, and the only EU member states who prohibit the detention of children is Ireland. And why is detention of migrant children more problematic? The answer is that the impact of the detention on a child's rights are more profound, and the child is more sensitive to abuse and violation of his or her protection rights. That's why a number of specific criteria and guarantees apply to the detention of minors under Article 37B2D of the CRC, as you can see it on the screen. First of all, Article 37B relates to permissible detention, as it states that no children should be deprived of his or her liberty unlawfully or arbitrarily. Article 37C relates to conditions of detention and requires that the child detained must be treated in accordance with the needs of persons of his or her age, must be separated from adults unless this is contrary to the child's best interest, must be kept together with his or her family, and must be allowed to communicate with relatives if the child is separated or unaccompanied. Article 37D contains rules concerning procedural protection. Detained children are entitled to legal assistance and the assistance of a guardian or advisor. In addition, the child detainee must be informed of the reasons for his or her detention in a manner appropriate to his or her age. Given the fact that all member states are state parties to the CRC, such states are obliged to ensure that their domestic law is fully compatible with the rights in the convention. And so their law should be compatible with these with these criteria of and guarantees which applies to detention of minors. From that point of view, I will speak about the European law governing the problematic of detention of minor children. Let's start with the detention of asylum seekers. At the beginning of the presentation, I said it's regulated under or by a reception conditions directive, specifically by Article 8, 9, 10, and 11. Article 11 specifically relates to detention of vulnerable persons and of applicants with special reception needs, including which are children. The best interest principle is reflected in Article 11, paragraph 2. Article 10 of the Reception Condition Directive lays down minimum standards relating to conditions of detention. In paragraph 1, it states that detention should, as a rule, take place in specialized detention facilities, but where it's not possible, member states may resort to prison accommodation. However, as we can see, Article 11.3 establishes that unaccompanied minors shall never be detained in prison accommodation. On the contrary, accompanied minors, which means children who travel with their parents or relatives, are susceptible to prison detention on the same basis as adults. So the prison detention is allowed in case of children traveling with their family, but it's not allowed in case of unaccompanied children, which means children who travel all alone. It could be seen, however, as the failure of EU legislator to exempt all minors in all circumstances from prison detention. And this is visibly contrary to the conditions of detentions as set out in the Article 37C of the CRC, which states that the minor detainee must be treated in a manner that takes account of his or her age. And here the question arises whether administrative detention in prison is appropriate for anyone under the age of 18 years, given the fact that the children are much more sensitive to bad conditions of which detention in prison surely is, than the adults. In Article 11, paragraph 2, the Reception Conditions Directive states that minors shall be detained only as a measure of last resort and for the shortest periods of time. However, the practice of the EU member states show that they very often don't respect the measure of a detention as a last resort and for the shortest periods of time. Article 11, paragraph 2 does introduce an obligation that detained minors be given the possibility to engage in leisure activities such as play and recreational activities appropriate to their age. Unfortunately, these obligations can be derogated according to the Article 11, paragraph 6, in duly justified cases and for a reasonable period that shall be as short as possible. When the asylum seeker is detained at a border post or transit zone other than as part of an accelerated admissibility procedure. Another violation of Article 37C of the CRC can be found in the practice of member states, and many of them deny detained minors access to education and other leisure activities. Generally speaking, reception condition directive contains some guarantees to ensure best interest of detained children, but unfortunately, it does not fully respect the requirements of Article 37 CRC. And it's the same case with pre-removal detention, which is regulated by return directive. Return directive contains three articles relating to the detention of illegally staying third country nationals. who are subject to written procedures. Specifically, Article 17 contains provisions relating to detention of minors and families. Same as in the Reception Condition Directive, it is stated that unaccompanied minors and families with minors shall only be detained as a measure of last resort and for the shortest appropriate period of time. Also, best interest of the child principle is explicitly reflected in Article 17, paragraph 5. Detention. Generally, detention of minors as a last resort requires member states to favor alternative solutions and to resort to the detention of minors only in the most serious cases. But as I have already outlined, this is unfortunately not the practice in EU, when just 24 member states provide for alternatives to detention. However, not many of them actually use them. Domestic laws in some countries provide some restrictions on the use of immigration detention measures in the case of children. For example, Belgium, Bulgaria, France, Hungary, Italy, Slovakia, and Spain limit the use of detention in the case of unaccompanied children, who are the children who travel alone, as I have previously outlined. In Poland and in the Czech Republic, children below 15 years cannot be detained, while in Austria and Latvia, this age limit is 14. As I already said, the only EU state which prohibits the immigration detention of children in asylum and return procedures is Ireland. And we are now at the end of my presentation with the question for you. You can think through this question: if immigration detention ever be in line with the principle of the best interest of the child, given the fact that it affects his mental and physical health, sometimes irretrievably. The aim of the lecture was to briefly outline the EU legislation on the detention of minors for the purposes of migration and asylum procedures. Although the detention of children on the basis of the migratory status of themselves or their parents is strictly rejected by international law, as well as by many international and non-governmental organizations, arguing that this is in direct conflict with the best interests of the child and clear violation of children's rights, this practice is still widespread in many member states of the European Union, with only a few countries resorting to alternative solutions. For the future, I think that the role of the European Union should be to encourage member states to make greater use of alternatives to detention of migrant children. Now I thank you for your attention. I hope you found the presentation useful. And if you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact me on this email address, and have a nice rest of the lectures and of your day.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Also for staying the limit of time, but not also for that, of course, this interesting presentation. It is a multi-level presentation, no? The best interest of the child, according to the International Convention of the United Nations, according to the European Union directives, and according to the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. As well. So I have a question for you, but later on during the discussion. It is really an interesting presentation. So now we can conclude the session of this morning. We started with the migration crisis, the first presentation. Then with the religious freedom and discrimination. Then with the best interest of the child, and now to we give a glance to the problem of security with with the problem of migration, law and security. The next and last but not least speaker is Dr. Gian Maria Milani, senior lecturer of comparative public law in the University of Siena, and also a member of the organization staff of this important congress of these days. His presentation is titled Nationality and Security in the European Context. Gian Maria, you have the floor, please.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you very much, Professor Piergigli, for giving me the floor. It's a great pleasure for me to be here today and to take part to this webinar that is actually the final meeting of this Jean Monnet project BISEC, which I have the pleasures to implement. So first of all, let me thank you, my colleagues of the University of Siena and of the other partners of the project, starting from Professor Marco Ventura, the coordinator of the project, and also let me thank professors Riccardo Pavoni and Alessandro Palmieri, who organized this very, very interesting and rich final meeting. As Professor Piergigli said, the topic of my intervention will be is actually the relationship between nationality and security in the European context, and I will try to first of all present very shortly this relationship in a general perspective with some very brief examples, and then I will try to demonstrate how the securitarian approach in nationality matters is growing, in particular presenting the Italian case that, in my opinion, is a quite useful case study in this field. The starting point of my intervention is quite obvious. That is to say, that the integration of new individuals into the national societies is undoubtedly one of the most ambitious, most difficult, most important challenges that Europe is facing in the last years, in the last decades, at least starting from the beginning of the present century. According to some data, some official data, the latest data available, more than 22 million people residing in 2019 in the European Union are not citizens of the Union. That is to say, the 4.8% of the total population. And only in 2018, 2.4 million of third country immigrants arrived in the European Union. And more than 670,000 people obtained the citizenship of an European Union country. This transformation of Europe into a land of immigration has been faced in the very last years through the adoption of a so-called securitarian approach with respect to the migratory phenomenon in general and the status of the aliens, of the foreigners. A securitarian approach which is now emerging both at a supranational and at a national level. In particular, at a supranational level and at European level, especially, this evolution is quite clear if we look at the evolution of the multi-year programs developed by the European Council over the last decades, starting from 1999, in order to set the general guidelines on immigration in the European Union. If we look to the first program signed in Tampere in 1999, we can find a very favorable approach, or a quite favorable approach at least, with respect to the arrival of migrants coming from third countries, with a special emphasis on the protection of the rights of migrants and the importance of fostering the integration of migrants into the national society. But if we look at the second, already at the second program signed in the Hague in 2004, we find a very different approach. The focus shifts from the guarantee of rights, from the fostering of integration, to the protection of security, also due to an international climate made tense by the growth of international terrorism. And among the objectives of the second program, we can find, for example, the contrast of illegal migration, the development of a more effective border control, and so on. And the same restrictive line, the same restrictive approach can be found in the third and fourth program signed respectively in Stockholm 2009 and Ypres 2014. And if we move from the programs to the act, the strict relationship between the law of foreigners and security finds more and more space. Probably the most evident result of this relationship is the detention of migrants and asylum seekers, as Dr. Casalova said. Measures of detention provided both by European directives and by national legislation in force in this field. Another example of this relationship is the introduction in a growing number of national systems of some crimes clearly, strongly related to the migration phenomenon, such as the crime of illegal immigration. In the very last years, this securitarian approach is interesting, is affecting another specific area, let me say, of the law of foreigners, that is the citizenship legislation, the citizenship law. In many countries, as a matter of fact, measures that provide, for example, the deprivation of citizenship on security grounds are debated, are approved, often posing very important problems of compatibility of these acts with the constitutional law of the European member states, but also with the international law applicable to the matter. In the last years, in the last decade in particular, and in particular in the last part of the past decade, several European countries have changed their nationality acts, including, as I said, new grounds for the revocation of citizenship. For example, the Netherlands, Finland, and Denmark changed their legislations in order to permit the withdrawal of citizenship to those individuals convicted for terrorist activities. Germany as well is a quite controversial example of this approach. Germany changed its nationality law in 2019 with the third law amending the Citizenship Act. And according to the amendment, anyone who concretely participates in the fighting of a terrorist organization abroad will lose his or her German citizenship. Such participation is considered, according to the amendment, as an act which is disloyal to Germany, and the conduct of such person is considered to be seriously prejudicial for the vital interest of Germany. Nonetheless, and this is an important point also in comparison with the Italian case, as Article 16 of the Basic Law prohibits loss of nationality if it renders the person stateless, the withdrawal of citizenship is only possible if the person has dual citizenship, if the person has a multiple citizenship. And this point has been strongly criticized by some scholars because in some sense it creates two categories of citizens. Citizens with a single nationality, who are not affected by the possible revocation of citizenship, and citizens with a multiple nationality, who can be affected by the revocation of citizenship. France as well debated about the possibility to change its nationality legislation and to introduce a case of revocation of citizenship in case of conviction for terrorism. In particular, in 2015, the French government presented a constitutional reform bill entitled in a quite significant way, Constitutional Bill for the Protection of the Nation, according to which Article 34 of the French Constitution, which established that the law establishes the rule on nationality, would have been completed with a new paragraph, specifying that such law on nationality would have included the conditions under which a French person who holds another nationality can be stripped of French nationality when convicted of a crime constituting a serious threat to the nation. But as is well known, the constitutional bill has been strongly criticized and finally dropped and finally rejected. Italy as well is part of this trend, and if it is possible, Italy anticipated this trend, the connection between nationality and security. The Italian social reality is that of an increasingly composite society. The immigration phenomenon that have interested Italy in the last years can be summarized in the numbers of foreigners who are nowadays present in Italy, more than 5 million out of a total population of 60 million. In order to face this social transformation, the Italian legislator intervened from the 90s, both in the field of immigration by approving an immigration code in 1998 and in the field of citizenship by approving a new law in 1992. Both acts have been the subject of changes in the last decade, starting from, in particular, from 2008, 2009, often in the name of security, directed at strengthening the security of the nation. In particular, I would like now to briefly present the securitarian evolution of the citizenship law in Italy and the problems that this approach poses in terms of constitutional and international law. First of all, in this perspective, I would like to shortly present the general framework on nationality in Italy. The law regulating the Italian citizenship is the law number 91 of 1992, called New Norms Regulating Citizenship. That is a law which regulates the ways in order to acquire and to lose the Italian citizenship. In particular, as far as the acquisition of citizenship is concerned, the law distinguishes between the acquisition of citizenship at birth and the acquisition of citizenship after birth. The absolutely dominant criterion in order to acquire the citizenship at birth is the jus sanguinis principle, according to which the individual born from an Italian father or mother is automatically an Italian citizen. The prevalence of this principle derives on the one hand from the absence of limits to the transfer of citizenship from generation to generation with this criterion, and on the other hand from the very limited application of jus soli, which is limited to avoid new cases of statelessness. And in fact, the jus soli is applied only for children of unknown parents, children of stateless parents, or children of parents who are citizens of states applying only jus soli. But with regard, on the other side, to the citizenship acquired after birth, which is probably more important in my presentation of today, the most important procedures established by the Law 91 of 1992 are citizenship by declaration, citizenship by marriage, and citizenship by naturalization. Unlike citizenship at birth, citizenship after birth is not automatically achieved, but it requires an expression of willingness by the person concerned, by the individual wishing to obtain the citizenship. Citizenship by declaration, in particular, can be obtained by individuals born in Italy who have legally resided there until the age of majority and who apply within 1 year after their majority. While citizenship by marriage may be acquired by subjects who have been married with an Italian individual for at least 2 years in case of residence in Italy or 3 years in case of residence abroad. Even naturalization is subordinated to an expression of willingness of the individual, of the person concerned, but in this case, this expression of willingness is not sufficient, is necessary, but not sufficient, because the final decision about naturalization is left to the discretion of the public administration. The law establishes some criteria that the subject wishing to naturalize has to meet, and for example, the most important ones are the residence of 10 years in the Italian territory, and the sufficient linguistic knowledge of the migrant, of the foreigner, but nonetheless, the public administration, the authorities, can also verify some other elements which characterize the person concerned, for example, the absence of convictions, the possession of a sufficient income, the respect of the fiscal obligations, and so on. So the norms regulating naturalization establish a procedure according to which the discretion of the public administration is very broad, and this discretion is also clear by the fact that the possibilities of appeal against the decisions rejecting the application for naturalization are very, very limited. The Council of State, the Italian Council of State, with its jurisprudence, made clear that the judicial control of the rejecting decisions is limited to the logic, the consistency, and the sufficiency of the motivation. So this is the general framework, very shortly, of the Italian legislation on citizenship, a legislation which has been the subject of a very huge, very long and animated debate in the public opinion, in the political life, and also in the academic sphere of Italy. Since 1992, in order to have an idea about the importance of this debate, that is to say, since the year of the approval and entry into force of the Act, more than 150 bills have been proposed, have been initiated before the Italian Parliament with the aim of partially or totally modifying the legislation of force. Nonetheless, we can see that the only significant changes to this legislation finally have been approved in 2009 and in 2018 in the name of security, according to the securitarian approach, which I have described at the beginning of this presentation. Already the title of the acts amending the law of 1992 are quite connected with this approach, with this securitarian approach. In 2009, the legislator intervened with the approval of the so-called security package, Law 94-2009. In 2018, the new amendment was approved through the adoption of the so-called security decree, converted in Law 132 of 2018. Both acts contain many provisions aimed at modifying the immigration code of 1998, but they contain also very significant provisions modifying the nationality law. In 2009, for example, the security package has introduced measures to make the acquisition of citizenship by marriage more difficult, mainly by enlarging the period of residence provided in order to apply for citizenship, in particular with the scope of contrasting the phenomenon of marriage of convenience. Moreover, the same security package introduced the payment of an amount of 200 euros for presenting the application for naturalization. But probably the modification approved in 2018 are probably more important and more worrying. With regard from one side to the acquisition of citizenship, the security decree of 2018 increased the cost for the submission of the applications, in particular for naturalization, and extended the deadline for replying to the applications themselves. But probably the most worrying changes to the nationality legislation are those concerning the revocation of citizenship, the withdrawal of citizenship, in line to what we have seen in other European countries. The original text of the Italian Nationality Act, as approved in 1992, established very, very limited cases, very, very limited grounds in order to withdraw the Italian citizenship. In particular, according to Article 12, the Italian citizenship is lost by a citizen that has accepted a job or a public office or a military service in a foreign state and does not comply with the request of the Italian government to give up this job, this public service, or this military service, or by a citizen that during a war with a foreign state performs or accepts a military service, a public office, or a job for that state. So very, very limited cases for loss of the citizenship. In addition to the loss of citizenship regulated by Article 12 of the law of 91 of 1992, the security decree of 2018 added the hypothesis of revocation of citizenship that is now regulated by Article 10 bis of the law 91 of 1992. According to this amendment, citizenship acquired by voluntary action, that is to say only citizenship acquired after birth, in particular by declaration, by marriage, and by naturalization, can be revoked in case of conviction for the crimes of terrorism and subversion of the constitutional order. This disposition justified by its supporters in the name of security, to say according to the securitarian approach, raised some very, very important doubts concerning its compliance with different articles of the Italian Constitution, starting from Article 22, according to which the Italian nationality, the Italian citizenship cannot be revoked, as well as the name and the Italian and the legal capacity for political reasons. But probably the most evident conflict of these dispositions with the Italian Constitution concern Article 3 of the Italian Fundamental Law. Article 3, which contains the principle of equality, and which implicitly also includes the principles of reasonableness and proportionality. According to this article, and according to the constant interpretation made by the Constitutional Court, equal situations must be treated in an equal way, and distinct situations must be treated in a reasonable, distinct way. And the revocation of citizenship, as regulated by Article 10 bis, according to the amendment of 2018, seems to fail on both sides. On the one hand, it treats same situations or similar situations in different ways. In fact, the law distinguishes the individuals who acquired the citizenship by natural fact at birth and those who acquired the citizenship by voluntary fact after birth, making applicable only to the latter, only to citizens by voluntary fact, the measure of revocation of citizenship. This differentiation does not seem reasonable because it seems to discriminate against individuals convicted for the same crime on the basis of the way in which they acquired citizenship. On the other hand, the provision concerned treats different situations in an equal way. And the reference in this case is to the fact that the law does not provide for exceptions relating to the individuals who, if affected by the measure of revocation, could become stateless. It not differentiate between citizens with a unique nationality and citizens with multiple nationalities, as done, for example, as we have seen by Germany. This last remark leads us to examine a last problematic point in terms of constitutional law related to the possible violation of Article 117 of the Italian Constitution, which obliges the legislator to respect the international obligations of Italy. And Italy, as a matter of fact, has signed and ratified several international treaties that place the obligation to reduce the case of statelessness, to avoid the new cases of statelessness, an obligation that would be quite clearly violated by the legislative provisions that provides for the possibility of increasing these situations of statelessness by revoking citizenship. In conclusion, in my opinion, we can say that citizenship in Italy, as well as unfortunately, in a growing number of European countries, so considered and so regulated according to this securitarian approach, is less and less an instrument of integration, an instrument of inclusion, and more an instrument of exclusion and differentiation. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you to Dr. Gianmaria Milani for your presentation with, I can make a sum up of your presentation with these keywords: security, securitarian approach, integration or non-integration, and citizenship. No, three words that can sum up your presentation. So it was a really interesting session, in my opinion. We have enough time, more or less 45, 50 minutes for the discussion. So if anyone can start with some questions or observations to the speakers, can write by chat the question, or can take the floor and ask directly to one speaker or to more than one speaker. So if everybody is interested to master something, is welcome to make an intervention, please. Let's give a look if there is somebody.
Perhaps I may jump in.
Okay, yes. Please introduce yourself.
Oh, yeah, sure. My name is Matteo Corsolidi, and I'm a PhD candidate at University of Siena Law Department and PhD research at Bruno Kessler Foundation based in Trento. Yeah, thank you all for these brilliant presentations. And I just have a question for Daniele, since we are colleagues in Law and Religion. I think his paper stimulated great food for thought. Now, Daniele, I'm glad that you mentioned intersectional discriminations. This is a very interesting and patterns where different kinds of discrimination seems to add up to a unique equation which complicates judicial settlement of discrimination disputes, actually. And I was wondering whether or not the COVID fears themselves could add up as a variable to these patterns of intersectional discriminations. It seems that because of great fears from COVID, migrants and religious people have been persecuted, and they have been denied access to public services or the public sphere themselves. But within public spheres, my intuition is that things could go even the other way around. Now, most of the people, as we know, wear cloths or medical masks. So it seems that concealing something, it has become normal, right? And in some countries, it seems that, say, women wearing niqabs have grown greater acceptance, or at least they have not been targeted for religious practices as much as they were before. So my question would be, do you think that this could be a chance to debunk some of the main and mainstream legal arguments against religious garments in the public sphere, which would be matters of security and public order and linguistic barriers as well? So would this be a chance to give a more lenient constitutional interpretation of what public order is, so that perhaps it could be given more weight and ground to proportionality and reasonability criteria in the balancing exercise of religious freedom matters? Thank you very much.
So, Daniele Ferrari, if you want to answer.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for this really interesting question. I think that there are a lot of dimensions of intersection between the pandemic situation and the religious phenomenon, the religious element. In illegal and phenomenological terms, why? Because of this exigence to protect people to coronavirus create a new limitation for the freedom of religion, and these limitations are justified by the science. It's interesting because there isn't, under this decision to close the churches, to close the worship place, a really pure, a really political decision. but there is also a scientific narrative approach to justify the limitation. And in this sense, I observe a competition, the traditional competition between the scientific approach, the science and the religion. Because religion has the problem to remodulate, redefine its existence face to this problem of coronavirus. But sometimes there is also a really interesting phenomenon of appropriation of the coronavirus in theological terms. You said about the dimension of intersectional discrimination in this specific field, in this specific situation. It's interesting that some religious actors use mobilized coronavirus to produce, to justify discrimination, for example, homophobia against other people. Coronavirus doesn't only produce a discrimination in the sense of the use of religion to limit the access to medical care, but it's also an element mobilized by religious actors to justify discrimination against, for example, sexual minorities. And it's really interesting because in phenomenological terms, it's a dynamic reappropriation of the virus against the scientific approach, but also to justify a manifestation of religion against the respect of human rights of each other. And there's also another point in your question about the religious symbol, but here there is the classical problem of the power, who has the power to define the meaning of religious symbol. Because in French, when the French parliament introduced the law against the dissimulation du visage, there is the idea that the niqab is something against the dignity of women, is something against gender equality. The burqa is something against the equality between men and women. But this interpretation of the religious symbol is produced, mobilized, promoted by an institution of the state. And I think that it's in this moment it's difficult to understand if there is a possibility to say that at the end the mask has the same meaning and the same impact in the public perception and also in the protection of public order as a burqa or niqab. I think that in French it isn't possible because in the approach linked to the laïcité, it isn't possible to say that the mask has the same meaning in the public sphere as the burqa or the niqab. I understand your point of view. It's really interesting, but I think that the answer and the possibility of development change in function of the state that you want to consider. In French, I think that it's really problematic to mobilize the mask as an argument to remodulate the order public in relation with the freedom of religion or belief. I don't know if I answered to your question, but thank you very much. It's really, really interesting.
Thank you. I think that coronavirus pandemic is compelling us in the coming months, in the coming weeks, is compelling all of us as persons, as citizens, as public bodies or public institutions to rethink our categories, the categories of discrimination on the basis of religion, language, culture, and so on, and is compelling us to rethink the issues concerning integration. No? So if at the beginning of this century we dealt with the problem of Islamic terrorism and the problem of finding the balance between personal rights, fundamental rights, individual rights, and public security, now we have to add another element to public security, a balance also with public health, now with the protection of public health. So the problem of managing this emergency is a problem also in order to find a solution to our old categories, to the categories of citizen or citizenship, of nationality, of integration, of discrimination and non-discrimination. So a new challenge is adding to the challenges that already we know during the last 20 years. I think that this pandemic could be an accelerator in some ways, an accelerator to try to solve old problems according to a new dimension, a new perspective, or on the other end, an accelerator to go down definitely, and it is of course not recommended at all. Are there anybody to ask questions? Marco Ventura, please.
I was just sharing the link with a webinar series that we run jointly with the University of Siena, FBK, and other partners on the COVID-19 crisis and religion, and in particular, freedom of religion and belief. Well, if I may, as I have the floor, one question for our speakers from Central Europe, which is probably more political than legal, but I think that Lubica and Katharina, if Katharina is still there, or other friends, for probably Professor Sturm is there. So, and the question would be, does a strong perception in Western Europe, that there's strong diversity of vision in terms of the European project, and in particular the European project as a space of free circulation, including circulation of migrants and circulation of rights to some extent. Is this, I'd like to ask our friends what their perception from Brno or from the Slovak Republic or from Prague would be in this regard. If there's anybody who feels like available for reacting. As stone I'm throwing in the pond.
So, your question is for Dr. Sakharova.
Well, I don't see Katharina in the attendance now. So, but
she left the.
Okay. But Lubica, yeah. Lubica Sakharova should be there, and I don't know if she would like to react. Or I also see Professor Sturma in the audience. So just in case you'd like to say something from EU law and international law perspective.
Please, Professor Sakharova. We cannot listen.
If I could
resume the question was what's the point of view on the circulation of migrants from the Central and Eastern European countries currently there has been a lot of changes, especially in the government. In Slovakia we had an election in March 2020, and this has been quite a big switch in the direction the country has been going the last 10 years, and now we are going somewhere else, and we don't know yet where, because of the pandemics regarding the foreign policy and the orientation to the European Union. So I'm curious, to be honest, myself, what's gonna be the status or the vision of the new foreign affairs to the migration crisis? So for now, there's been a lot of changes. Like in Hungary, it seems to be more stable. And we had, due to this election, we had a big switch of the direction of the policy, even the foreign policy. So we'll see from the Slovakian point of view. I don't know about the Czech Republic now. Maybe Professor Čurma could make a word. But if not, I can say that what I've been talking in my presentation was the SMB deadlock in that there is no consensus on the reform of the European asylum system, and I don't think that Hungary, Czech Republic, or Poland will change somehow. So maybe the way would be somewhere else to really reform the European security architecture, as I was speaking about. We'll see. What I was talking about was also the vision of Germany, and now the EU is maybe taking this approach as well. There was a meeting, high-level meeting also, and a joint communication to the European Parliament and the Council on this topic. So maybe European Union is really considering to take this the other way and maybe to reform and make structural changes that would also add the prevention of the conflict and the cooperation with the African Union as one pillar of all this. So we'll see.
Thank you very much.
Professor Paolo Čurma. Maybe he is not with us. No.
Sorry, Professor Pergi, I didn't understand whether Caterina Casalova is still with us or not.
I don't know. But in the meantime, I have a curiosity, an observation about the intervention of again. Professor Sakharova, in your opinion, you spoke about the cooperation, the dialogue between national states and the European Union with regard to migration flows, with regard to the better managing of migration flows. In your opinion, would it be better a bottom-up process in the light of improving the policy on migration flows in the European Union? Is it better to improve a bottom-up process from the national states to the European bodies? Or, on the contrary, is it better to build a top-down process from the European Union to the sovereign state? Or maybe in the middle is the right solution. I think about the proposals on behalf of some Mediterranean states, such as Spain, Italy, and Greece, to the European bodies, a proposal to establish something like mandatory quotas for redistributing the migrants in all the European states, and not only in Italy, Spain, or Greece, and so on. So is it better a process from the European Union to the national states, or to the national states to the European Union, so the national states can do their proposals to the European bodies, and so better improving this policy, according to your opinion?
From my point of view, the way would be definitely the European policy, the strength of the Europe as a European policy, and to really make the steps forward on that European level. There's not too much to do from the national level upwards. We can be inspired by the programs that Germany or Ireland or Austria has proposed, and we can consider those measures that they have proposed. But I don't think really this way would change something. What can do really a lot of change is the European solution for these things. What might be the problem, and what also showed it will be a problem, is the, unfortunately, the V4 countries, as included Slovakia. I hope for a change since the election. As I said, we had an election, and I hope this change will also come here. But I really doubt about Hungary and the other countries. They doesn't seem to change in some way. But what can change the thing will be also the dialogue or the discussions, and the discussion lead it the other way, not spreading the fear of migrants, but maybe the constructive measures, and talking to public also about the constructive measures, then will be taken on the level of European Union. I mean, these preventive measures could do the work because they're understandable from my point of view. If we talk to public and if we talk to people and start from the European countries itself, for example, with that measure that I have mentioned to ban exports of weapons, it is understandable for large public that is a message that, yes, look, we are doing something. We are beginning here, and we want to step by step build the architecture on the measures of prevention, and also maybe of some kind of soft security measures, and then also hard security measures. Maybe reforming the asylum system could be a way forward, and also the quotas. But if only the quotas will be the topic of a discussion, there's no way here. I mean, I see how public reacts in Slovakia also to this topic. People start to be allergic completely. So. Maybe also the way of communication should change a little. So, and I really find this way of dialogue between European Union and African Union. And if you could see Mrs. Van der Leyen, her first foreign trip was to the African Union, and she, as a president of Commission, she showed her will probably to communicate with African leaders on the strategy that can be created between those unions. So maybe that way could work.
Thank you. Caterina Casalova left the webinar, but if she wishes to address questions, she can use the email, right? But she can write an email to the organizer, to Isabella Mazet. Am I right? Am I wrong? Okay. Okay. Thank you. So, is anybody like to make a question to our speakers?
I would have a reaction to Gian Maria Milani's presentation, if I may. I found Dr. Milani's presentation incredibly rich and also on spot with the theme of our conference, because it's inquiring into the relationship between nationality laws and the impact on that of this increasing securitization of nationality laws, as he calls them. And, you know, just one, just one point. I would like him to tell me something more about the problem of statelessness, because he mentioned, I think he underlined very well what are the problems relating to the legality, the lawfulness of this 2018 Italian security decree. And he said very well that, you know, the major problem is that it does not make any proviso for stateless people. So there's no exclusion or any kind of exception with respect to stateless people. And he also said that this is going to be, this is probably incompatible with Italian international obligations. So it's also incompatible with Article 117 of our Constitution, Italian Constitution. Of course, his main reference was to the 54 New York Convention on stateless persons. On the other hand, I find here a bit paradoxical that on the other hand, in Germany, there is a prohibition of revocation of citizenship for stateless people. I didn't understand whether that is on the Constitution, on the Grundgesetz, or in a law. But and he also said that this kind of exception for stateless persons was criticized very much in Germany by certain scholars. So, you know, I do not understand here exactly the terms of the debate, because there is this different reaction by public on the problem of statelessness. And I would like him to tell us something more in this respect.
Gian Maria, please, if you want to answer.
Yes, yes, very shortly. Also, I have been surprised by this quite paradoxal criticisms that which are in some sense opposite. From one side, German scholars criticized the exception made by the German legislator, the differentiation made by the German legislator, and from the other side, the Italian scholars criticized the fact that the Italian legislator did not made any exception, any differentiation. So my very perhaps simplistic conclusion is that probably the problem is the revocation of citizenship as such. The German scholars criticize the measure because it differentiates between and they say this provision creates citizens of premium class and citizens of lower class, citizens who have a double nationality and citizens who have a single nationality, who are in some sense favored by this provision. On the contrary, as I told, the Italian scholars criticized the fact that the Italian legislation now permits new cases of statelessness. It make possible new cases of statelessness. Probably from an I'm not, as Professor Pavoni perfectly know, I am not a specialist of international law, but probably from an international law point of view, the German legislation, the German provision is more compliant with the international principles on the matter. I think, for example, about the distinction made between the right to nationality and the right to have one nationality, which have been debated. And in this perspective, the individual has not the right to a specific nationality, but at least a right to at least one nationality. And the German legislation, in my opinion, tend to respect at least this minimum threshold about the possess of nationality nationality status. Unfortunately, also at European level, as I wrote, as I said in other occasions, and in particular in the European Court of Human Rights system, we cannot find a useful point in order to verify the compliance of these legislations from an international law point of view. So yeah, yes, as I told, probably the problem is the revocation of citizenship as such, which is probably an excessive measure in general.
Thank you.
Thank you. I have a question, or I would like to ask an opinion to Daniele Ferrari about. Is you with us? Is you still with us?
Yes.
Yes, okay. An opinion about the coronavirus pandemic is teaching a lot, I think, as I told before. Do you think that this experience could strengthen or lower the sense of belonging inside, for example, religious communities, regardless Muslim or other, or belonging to other religions? But do you think that this pandemic experience in the next future will strengthen the sense of belonging to a community, for example, to a community where the single members stay together because of their common religion, or could reduce this sense of belonging on behalf of the community and on behalf of the state, for example? Which can be, in your opinion, the approach from the states, from the democratic states, and from the religious communities in front of this new challenge in the next future? It's only an opinion. I'm asking only an impression, a first impression.
But it's a really interesting question. I think that through the pandemic experience, it's really clear and it's really strong, this idea of belonging to humanity and this idea of a common responsibility. And it's something in competition with the idea of belonging to a specific religious community. It's something that change the idea of belonging in the light of the public obligation, the idea of distance, the idea to create a public manifestation of ourselves in according with a specific measure. And this is something sometimes in competition with churches, with the idea of religious community. But for example, in Italy, the Pope Francis developed a narrative approach to include his role as something useful to end the pandemic, but also in something to stress this idea of responsibility. And in this specific dynamic, I think that the technology, the impact of technology on religious dynamic is something interesting, because thanks to the technology, it's possible to celebrate a religious ceremony, for example, without the exigence to be physical present in a specific worship place. And this is an element, probably it's a transformation of the idea of belonging. It's another dimension of belonging. but probably it isn't something against the religious relation between the person and his religious community. But it's also true that in France, in this moment, the Conseil d'État said that the government hadn't the right to close churches and worship places. And in French, it's clear the conflict, because pandemic is represented, is pursued by religious actor as something mobilized by the state to limit religion. And in this sense, there is the idea that the French state use the virus to foster the link between the state and the citizenship against religion. Religion is in private, religion is, and in this moment, religion must be in private because there is the pandemic, there is this problem. And it's another dynamic. That's another dynamic, but it's also true that I think that at the end, it's incredible, this idea of virtual religious community, because in the past, there were a lot of different experiences, for example, for the Nijab Day of Muslim women that organize an online meeting to celebrate this day of their Muslim identity as women. But in this moment, I see this dynamic in phenomenological terms of creation of a virtual religious community. And it's something new. It's something that changes at the same time the definition of freedom of religion or belief in the application, in the translation to reality. Thank you very much for your question.
No, I thank you. I thank you because I will use this opinion, your impression with regard to one of the issues I studied. It is that of linguistic and cultural minorities. Maybe we can find something common with the religious communities and this sense of belonging in a certain sense. Is there anybody else who would like to make an intervention or a question? I cannot see. I remind you that you can also write by chat your question to our speakers. I ask our first organizer, Marco Ventura, if you can close, or if you have other questions, or if you...
I think it's been quite a dense morning, with a lot of food for thought. I'm very grateful to everybody. We can reconvene for the session in the afternoon, which is scheduled at 3 p.m. But I let you the conclusion of the session.
I thank you all. I thank all the participants, all the public, and especially, of course, our speakers of this morning. I think it was really a very rich and interesting panel with many interesting interventions. So I learned a lot from the panel of this panel. Thank you very much, and thank you for participating in this session. In the next session will start in the afternoon at 3 o'clock. Okay? Thank you very much.